Namaste. Today, we are going to look into the works of one of the most notorious of the missionary scholars who almost changed the course of politics of Soviet Union. His name is Bishop Robert Caldwell. Caldwell was an evangelist, belonged to Society for the Propagation of Gospels, or shortly called the SPG. We have to understand this Society for the Propagation of Gospels because then only we will be able to understand the mindset from which Caldwell was coming. This SPG was one of the largest holders of slave labor. They had slave laborers in entire Caribbean island, sugarcane growing island. All the slaves were branded with the S for SPG. And the bishops used to write letters like, for example, okay, the lords of men whom you had brought the last cargo, they had all died and now we need more slaves. Those kind of letters they used to write. Then came the battle for ending of slave labor. Here again, we have to understand one thing, that this crusade for ending the slave labor that was started in UK is mainly because the Caribbean sugar was being produced by slave labor, whereas the East India Company sugar was not produced with slave labor, but mostly with indentured laborers. And so there was a market competition, and that is the reason why they wanted to use the cause of abolition of slave trade to boost the market for East India Company produced sugar. So they get very clear economic equations behind all their so-called noble intentions. We have to understand that. And now, Caldwell comes from this SPG. And the SPG, of course, freed the slaves. They stopped the slave labor. They freed the slaves, but they got compensated for each and every slave that they freed. The slaves didn't get compensated. The SPG, which was the slave holder company, it got compensated. So this is the organization from which Caldwell was coming. We have to understand that. And Caldwell comes to South India and he starts his missionary work. And we have to give it to him, the fact that he was a very good scholar. He was a great linguistic scholar. At the same time, the work that he did was based on a previous work that had been done by a famous scholar called Ellis. And Ellis was a collector at that time of the British East India Company, which was at that time governing Madras. And Ellis had used the help of two Telugu Brahmins. And with the help of these Telugu Brahmins, the scholarship of the Telugu Brahmins, Ellis was working out a linguistic theory that the South Indian languages belonged to a particular family of languages, and its core grammar is somewhat different from that of Sanskrit. So this was Ellis' idea, and another one person called Campbell also collaborated with him, but Ellis never had any evangelical motivation for this linguistic speculation. In fact, Ellis was actually more favorably inclined towards Hinduism. When he was digging ponds, for example, he used to have all the Vedic rituals, etc. So essentially, Ellis was not a hater of Hindu culture. And he created this linguistic theory. Unfortunately, Ellis died in a very young age, and then nobody was interested in this particular work of his. And remember, this work of Ellis had also two collaboration of two important Telugu Sanskrit scholars, Indian Telugu Sanskrit scholars. And all these three, they created this, and it was sleeping. And then Caldwell comes, and Caldwell also it's essentially both these theories have a similarity, but Caldwell transformed the linguistic theory into a racial theory. he gives a racial framework. So he had this Dravidians who were, according to him, Scythians. And they came from outside India through the same type of Poland process that the Aryans used. And he came through, they came through this. And then they defeated the aboriginals here. And these aboriginals who were defeated by the Dravidians, they became the so-called untouchables. And after that, the Aryans came. Now, somehow these Dravidians had migrated to South India and they were living in South India. And the Aryans couldn't conquer them in war. So they sent their agents, the Brahmins, and the Brahmins came here. And they created this concept of Brahmins being Brahmins and non-Brahmins and all non-Brahmins being Shudras. So this is a kind of a fantastic theory that Caldwell created along with his linguistic theory. Now, if you look at his comparative grammar purely from a linguistic point of view, one can say that it is a scholarly work. There's no doubt about it. But the venom was the tail of the scorpion. The same way here, the evangelical venom was there. It transformed a linguistic theory and mapped it to your racial theory. And remember, Caldwell had this notion that the conquering race is a superior race. So to him, the Dravidians were superior to the aboriginals and the Aryans were superior to the Dravidians. But the Aryans introduced the caste system, and the Aryans also introduced what he called pantheistic ideas. And he called cynicism, he called dry rationalism. So this rationalism and the skepticism that Brahmins introduced, they were considered by Caldwell as kind of barriers to his own evangelical endeavors. He was trying to do his evangelism. He was born in 1814 and he lived till 1891. It was during the 1850s to 1870s and 80s that he was living in South India. And this is his important evangelical period. Now, in 1856, 1 year before the First War of Indian Independence, he had finished and he had published his comparative grammar of the Dravidian languages. And even today, it is hailed as a classic. In a way, it is a classic. But remember that the cardinal sin of Robert Caldwell was that he introduced the concept of race. He introduced a kind of a conspiracy theory into his general linguistic narrative. It was not a dispassionate, secular academic work. For him, this work was an evangelical tool, and it was a work was an anti-Hindu tool for him. We are not interpreting it. For him, it was an anti-Hindu evangelical tool. And with the help of this, he wanted to show that the cunning Aryans had come and they had introduced certain religious concepts. And these concepts have to be removed if the South Indians are to be converted to Christianity. So, as I said, it was part of his evangelical attempts, evangelical work, that this particular theory was formulated. Naturally, this theory said that all the Aryan or the Sanskrit words should be exorcised from the Tamil language. So Tamil language could stand on its own without a single Aryan or Sanskrit word. He wanted to purify Tamil. He wanted to kind of have a pure, chaste Tamil. Again, at the outset, it looks very wonderful. It appeals to the Tamil ego, that Tamil can stand on its own. But what is actually happening is this: any language always has a kind of an osmosis process, a linguistic osmosis, in which certain terms are got, certain methods are got, and then they are integrated to its own language. And then the language has an organic growth. And once you, if there is an artificial excessive inflow of foreign language, that is detrimental. The same way, if someone is going to remove each and every so-called foreign or alien words from a particular language and purify it, that is also would result in the death of that particular language. But remember, Caldwell was not interested whether Tamil lives or not. For him, the removal of all these so-called Sanskrit words from Tamil would make Tamil, would weaken Tamil, and it would make the Tamil society, Tamil psyche vulnerable to, conducive to the evangelical process. That was his aim. That was his target. He openly stated that also. He said that once all these concepts are removed, once all these terms are removed, then the only thing that stands between the Dravidian and his salvation through Christianity is essentially the density of his ignorance. That is the word he used. Density of his ignorance. Now, you have to understand that the worldview of Caldwell, Tamils were an inferior race. Tamils were not capable of any ethical thoughts with themselves. So to him, Thirukkural was actually, could not have come from the Tamil mind. And Thirukkural could not have come from a Vedic mind also. Because according to Caldwell and other evangelical ontologists, the Vedic mind is incapable of ethics. The higher ethics are only possible with the Jainism and Buddhism. But Jainism and Buddhism, they lacked a god, they lacked a deity, so they were deficient. So they had this idea that there is this Vedic religion, and this Vedic religion appeals to the lower senses. The Vedic religion appeals to the lower components of the mind, and hence people accept it, and it is nothing but priestcraft. It is nothing but caste oppression. It is nothing but power structures that were suppressing the people by giving them the opiate of popular beliefs, etc. And this is kind of a problem that had to be removed if evangelism is to happen. And the oppressed people by themselves, they are being inferior. So once these are removed, they will be like babies. They could be easily molded to anything that we want, in this case, evangelical Christianity. So this is how Caldwell operated. This is the project of Caldwell. And he also knows that it is going to be a long-term process. It is going to be a long-term project. So he was sowing the seeds like this. And he also did some anthropological studies of the communities that he wanted to evangelize. One such community was the Shanar or the Nadar community. And he said that the Shanars or the Nadars, they don't have any, essentially, they don't have a higher culture. They were basically aboriginal and they were devil worshippers. Now, this particular aspect, he then states that the aboriginals that are the Nadars or the Shanars, according to him, they were involved in a kind of devil worship, but it is in a way better because they don't have the Brahminical rationalism. That is the word he uses, the rationalism and skepticism of the Brahmins are not present here. So that way their religion is simplicity. Despite the fact that it is devil worship, a religion is very simplicity. And it is different from the so-called Brahminical Hinduism. Now you see that all the present day anti-Hindu discourses of the urban Naxals or the Breaking India Forces or whatever term that you use, the Marxists, the Maoists, Harvard professors, take anything. You will find that this is the same framework they use. They may not use the word devil worship, but they would say that these are our primitive nature worship and it doesn't have anything to do with the so-called Hinduism. But what actually happened at that time when Caldwell came out with this dubious thesis? The Nadar community, even those who got converted to Christianity, those of the Nadar community who got converted to Christianity, they were shocked by the way this man who was telling them that he was professing a religion of love and compassion and all that, how he was destroying their own heritage. He was essentially humiliating their ancestors and their heritage and their tradition, everything, just because he wanted some evangelical gain out of their degradation. And when they realized this, they started attacking him in a very scholarly way. And they said that this is not true. Whatever he had said is not true. And they took the examples of idol worship, or they took the examples of the gods they were worshipping. They compared it with the gods the so-called upper caste people were worshipping, and they pointed out that they were the same gods. The mode of worship was the same. They had their own priests, and they also involved in their dances involving altered states of consciousness, which Caldwell called devil dances. Now, these people told these are not devil dances. These are essentially dances in which the god or the goddesses descend on them. Then they pointed out, for example, that when you are telling that a person is possessed by the devil, there is a specific term. The term is called pay pidithal. Pidithal means it catches hold of you. Pay, as you know, it is essentially a bad spirit or a disembodied spirit. And it comes and catches you. That is how they call it. And then there is a term called Swami Adal. Swami, as you can know, as you would know very clearly, Swami means God or the goddess or the divine. And Adal means it is a dance. So it is the dance of an altered elevated state of consciousness in which a shaman or a priestess dances, which is qualitatively different from the devil possession. So both involves movement of the body, but one is different from the other. We have different terms for them. Despite the fact that there are different terms, Caldwell, despite the fact that he had lived here, he had studied the language, he was intentionally confusing the terms. He was intentionally selectively presenting the facts and trying to project, trying to erase the cultural heritage of a people. This is what he was doing. When the Shanas pointed this out, Caldwell got into trouble. He never expected this kind of retaliation from the people he regarded as kind of people who are dense. They're filled with the density of ignorance inside their cranial box. That is how he had pictured us. But when our people reacted strongly, he had no other way to go. He had to abandon the place of his field work, his evangelical field, and he had to go to some mountain places like Kodaikanal. And all these people, we have to remember another one aspect here. Caldwell, he could purchase estates of spices in Tamil Nadu. So these were not people who were kind of renunciates who are coming here and serving the people. No, evangelism was a very profitable profession for these people. They came here, they worked here, and then they got money, they purchased lands and estates, and they lived a very comfortable life. They lived a very comfortable life at those times. And then they also sowed seeds of discord. So these are the kind of people, the evangelists who came here. And when, apart from these aspects, when Caldwell was working here, a big famine came over India, particularly South India. It is called the Thadu Varsha Pancham, or the Great Madras Famine. In this, almost 9 to 10 million people died. Caldwell, and like most evangelists even today, like for example, the World Vision, whenever a natural disaster strikes, these people make use of natural disasters as evangelical opportunities. Human misery for them becomes evangelical capital. The same way Caldwell was no different. Caldwell also used it, used the great famine that killed 9 to 10 million Indians. He used it. He put advertisements in London newspapers telling that this famine has made people come to the churches, get baptized like anything. We should make use of this particular situation. Caldwell placed an advertisement. It so happened, somebody from Tamil Nadu was there in London at that time. He saw this particular advertisement placed by Caldwell. He was a Hindu. And he thought, what is this? We have never heard like this, anything like this. if such mass conversions are happening, somebody should talk about it, but nobody was talking about it. So what is actually happening? What he did, he came back and he went to a newspaper called Madras Mail. The Madras Mail sent its reporter, and people also started going there and searching the church records and everything. They discovered that nothing like this had happened. And then there were letters to Madras Mail telling that the whole thing is a hoax. No conversions like that had happened in and around Tirunelveli at that time, etc., etc. And Caldwell was kind of exposed at that time, but he was able to wriggle out of it. So Caldwell was very, very, very clear about why he was functioning here. Today, Caldwell is projected as if he is a father of the Dravidian movement. He is a person who has contributed vastly to Tamil's emancipation of Tamil, empowerment of Tamil as a language, etc., etc. Caldwell definitely contributed to the field of linguistics. That particular contribution is scholarly, no doubt about it. At the same time, the sustained contribution, the contribution that is having an impact, is the creation of the Dravidian movement as a political movement with hatred at its core, a racist ideology at its core. And for that, Caldwell contributed. So Caldwell should actually be called as the father of Dravidianist racism. He should be considered just like an anti-Semite, he should be considered as an anti-Hindu. We should be very clear about it. He was a person who sowed hatred. He used academics to sow hatred. And this trend is even today continuing. We have to understand this as much. So Caldwell, what he did was, he corrupted a linguistic exploration. He converted a science into an ideology of hatred, and thus he blurred the boundaries between proper linguistic research and racial hatred. This is what he did. Now, was he, could it be that with respect to at least the Nadar community, he could have been ignorant genuinely? That is a question many people are raising today. They're telling that, okay, Caldwell came from some long distance and he couldn't understand what was happening here, and that is why he presented the Nadar community as aboriginals and all that kind of things. Could it be that? Answer again is no. When Caldwell was working in Tirunelveli, there was a great saint who was working in Travancore, South Travancore, which is today the Kanyakumari district. His name was Ayya Vaikuntha. Ayya Vaikuntha was a great visionary and also a great spiritual social reformer. His followers venerate him as the avatar of Vishnu. And in his songs, in his outpourings, he talked about two evils. One he called Vennisam, which means essentially the white evil person. And another one he called the Kalinism, which means essentially the evil of the Kali age. By Kalinism, he considered the social stagnation, the oppressive social condition that was present in South Travancore. And by Vennisam, he meant the evangelical colonial administration that was beginning to have the stranglehold over the South Travancore. The South Travancore of that time, the colonial company, essentially the British East India Company, had taken the control of the entire royal system. The royal family was placed as a kind of a mask, but the real string pullers were the company, and the company employed a lot of evangelists as magistrates and tax collectors, etc. So they showed a lot of partiality to people who got converted, and they were having a playing field of converting people using the very oppressive social conditions, socioeconomic conditions, which in turn was created by the colonial exploitation and impoverishment of the nation, the place. And Ayya Vaikunda was fighting against both, and he was arrested by the Travancore king. And in most of the modern narratives, it is said that the Travancore king arrested Ayya Vaikunda because Ayya Vaikunda was against the so-called upper caste people, and he was organizing all the Jati people into a mass movement. But Caldwell, who was a contemporary, makes note of Ayya Vaikunda, and he talks in very harsh terms against Ayya Vaikunda. He considers him as a kind of an evil person, a cheat, a con man, and all those kind of negative things he says. And then he records an important thing, that the aim of Ayya Vaikunda was to remove the East India Company and the British dominion from the entire country. And then he says, fortunately, it was not successful, and so on and so forth. Now, Ayya Vaikunda very clearly states that the Nodars were Kshatriyas, that the Nodars were born of the eyes of Maharishi, and they were nurtured by Kali herself, and hence they are the sons and daughters of Kali. So Ayya Vaikunda is very, very clear about the status of the cultural heritage of Nodars, and this cultural heritage he very strongly identifies with Ramayana, Mahabharata, and Skanda Purana. Yet Caldwell, knowing all this, was able to write the so-called anthropological treatise on Nodars, telling the world that they were aboriginals. They didn't have any spiritual or religious heritage like the rest of the Hindus. So Caldwell provides us a classic example of how the anti-Hindu academia works, and how the anti-Hindu academia has its roots in the world evangelism, in the world evangelical worldview. So if you see today, academics, a section of media, a section of academics talking about the tribals not being Hindus, the so-called scheduled communities not being Hindus, the so-called scheduled tribes not being Hindus, then you have to remember that this is an evangelical framework created with the purpose of converting people, removing people from the larger body of the Hinduism. Risley helped in this. The entire colonial missionary helped in this. The entire government and the evangelical system helped in this. They have invested in this. And what we are seeing today in our present anti-Hindu environment is the dividends of this investment that has been made by people like Caldwell. So Caldwell, the ghost of Caldwell, even today lives. It lives in the fantasy of a separate existence of Tamil. There is no such thing as a separate existence of Tamil. Tamil has been part of the pan-Indic cultural sphere, the cultural matrix, the spiritual matrix. It has contributed substantially to the development of the entire Indian culture. Then Indian, rest of Indian landmass has also contributed to the cultural evolution of Tamil. So Tamil cannot be seen in isolation. If you take Tamil out of its Hindu spiritual matrix, then Tamil will be dead. It would lose all its vitality. It would lose all its aesthetics. It would lose all its creativity. In fact, that is exactly what Caldwell wants. Caldwell wants Tamil to be taken out of its cultural context, just like taking a fish out of a water. Once it's taken out, then its life would be gone and its form alone would remain. If form alone remains, then either it could be put into museum or it could be used like a puppet. That is exactly what Caldwell wants. That is exactly what every anti-Hindu academic wants. That is exactly what every anti-Hindu propagandist in the media and polity wants. And the works of Caldwell show what exactly is wrong with the academic study of Hinduism from a colonial roots. So we have to study Caldwell. for three reasons. One, how he took a very serious scientific linguistic discipline and then used it for his evangelical purposes, creating a hate politics out of it, a hate movement out of it, number one. Number two, how he uses anthropology to make a community disinherit its Hindu heritage so that it could be debased, and once it is debased, then it could be converted to Christianity. Three, how he used natural disasters to catalyze evangelism. So in all these three counts, Caldwell emerges as a very good specimen for Hindus, Hindu scholars to study. And then we have to know that Caldwell is not a phenomenon of the past. Caldwell lives, still lives in the anti-Hindu hatred that permeates academia, polity, and media. Thank you so much.